will be on every Friday in February from 10 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. This is a paid class, and you can give them a call at 310-544-1948. And there's a lot of good events there, too. They have a wonderful fuchsia collection, and it's just a wonderful location down there at the South Coast Botanic Garden. So that's our upcoming events today, and let's talk a little bit about our mystery plants. And now this is a mystery genus. And this is, now to tell you the truth, I've lost my species names. This is one species within the genus. This is a different species in the same genus. And here is yet another species within the same genus. And if you notice, they only have leaves. They really don't even have roots. And they're not in pots. This is how they grow naturally. They'll grow on telephone lines, on top of things. I don't want to give away too much. But this is a mystery genus. And perhaps this is a good time to talk a little bit about the nomenclature of plant materials or plants in general. And what I mean when I say genus. So if you know what this is, give us a call. There's a common name for it and, of course, the actual name of the genus. And I don't have the species names for these three because I didn't keep track of it. I should know this one. But I've got a lot from over the years, and I just lose track of the species names. I'd take them down to the rainforest flora in Torrance, and they would tell me what they are because that's rainforest flora and botanic garden down in Torrance is one of the main growers of this genus in Southern California. So when I say genus, what am I talking about? Well, the name of a plant has two parts. The first part is called the genus. The second part is called the specific epithet. So let's take, for instance, and that's true of all organisms, all living organisms, whether it's mammals or plants or insects, they get they're in a genus, and they are a species within the genus that's delineated by the specific epithet. So humans, what is our Latin name or our scientific name? It's Homo sapien. Homo is the genus, and it's the genus for man. And sapien means smart. And we could debate that, but that is the specific epithet. When you put the two together, that's the species name. The species name is not sapien. Sapien is the specific epithet for the species. The species name is Homo sapien. So let's take an example of a plant. Let's take, and we talked about camellias already on the show a week ago. And the camellia is the genus. There are about 200 species of camellia. The most commonly grown one is Camellia japonica. Japonica is the specific epithet. Camellia is the genus. Together, Camellia japonica is the species. Now, plants also have families. And so a family will be composed of genera, or many different genuses. That plural is actually genera. And so camellias belong to the Theaceae. The Thea is the name genus for the family. Every family has a name genus. So the grass family is Poaceae. The old name is Graminae, but the more modern name is Poaceae. And the name genus is Poa. Poa is a genus of grasses in the grass family. So what I'm asking for is the genus for these. And so I wanted to explain that. Now there's some additional terms that are used in horticulture when we talk about cultivated plants. When you talk about a species, you can have naturally occurring varieties. And we'd call that a variety if it occurs naturally over the range where the plant grows. So if you were to look at, say, California coast live oak, and the name of that is Quercus agrifolia. Quercus is the genus for all oaks. If you're an oak, you're in the genus Quercus. And Quercus agrifolia, and agrifolia means water loving, and that's a funny thing to say because they are extremely drought tolerant. But they do grow in close proximity to streams usually, but not right in streams. They're not riparian. They don't grow in streams, but they're often found close by. So Quercus agrifolia. The range is all, where does it naturally grow? It grows anywhere from San Francisco all the way down to San Diego. And as much as 100 miles inland. So it has a pretty big distribution. That's a pretty large area. And not to be unexpected, if you go up and look at some at the northern end of the range, they might look a little different from the ones at the southern end of the range. So you might actually have varieties that naturally occur within the distribution of the population. So there's a little, so those differences might be called a variety. If you go out into a population of plants in a natural area, and you find one individual that has a unique characteristic different from the rest, and you take it back home, the seeds or cuttings, or dig up the whole plant, and you take it back and you start growing it and propagating it and selling it, now it's a cultivated variety. And there's a, and that's one way to get a cultivated variety, is to go out and find them naturally. Another way would be to collect seeds off a plant, grow thousands of seedlings, maybe of trees, and then start saying, well, I like this one because it has darker red leaves in the fall, or I like this one because the flowers are bigger. And so then you take that one and you start mass producing it. You start cloning it with either cuttings or a variety of way of mass producing identical copies of that one individual. That becomes a cultivated variety, and we refer to that as a cultivar. And when we list the name of a cultivar, we put it in single quotes. So, and in fact, man has been doing this for literally thousands of years, selecting of plants from the wild and then propagating them and then crossing them with other plants that they wouldn't normally cross with, and ending up with hybrids or other what you would call cultivated varieties. That is abbreviated as cultivar. So if I say cultivar, I'm talking about a cultivated variety that was really selected by man, propagated and widely distributed. For an example, apples. Well, apples have been around for a long time. There are approximately 10,000 different cultivated varieties of apples. So you can see that it's important, because if you want a specific apple, if you want to buy a Golden Delicious, that is a cultivated variety. So you need to go ask for, I want to grow Golden Delicious. If you want to grow an Anna or a Beverly Hills or a... what's the other one? Gordon, which are low chill variety apples, well suited to Southern California. You have to ask for that. You have to say, I want an Anna. And what you'll see on the tag, or if you see it talked about, Malus is the genus for apple. It'll say Malus, and then in single quotes, it'll say Anna or Gordon or Beverly Hills, because that's a cultivated variety. The same for roses. If you want to buy a specific rose, a Chrysler Imperial, or a Peace, or a John Kennedy, and there's probably at least 10,000 named roses. And if you just go buy a rose and bring it back and don't pay any attention to the cultivated variety, you don't know if you're getting a white rose, a red rose, a climbing rose, a bush rose, a floribunda, a hybrid tea. I mean, I actually have a whole lecture on roses, and we'll talk about that at more length when we talk about roses. But I'm just trying to demonstrate how plants are named, and so you can understand when I start talking about either a species, or I'm talking about a variety, a naturally occurring variety, which we don't call a cultivar or a cultivated variety, or if I'm talking about really a selected cultivated variety that is being grown in nursery production and sold to the public and grown in gardens. And most of us deal with cultivated varieties. A lot of our trees may be just species, but a lot of the plants we grow in our gardens are cultivated varieties and selected for very specific characteristics and traits. Color of the flower, scent of the flower, the size of the fruit. Think of all the tomatoes out there. There's Early Girl, Better Boy, Purple Cherokee, Roma. Those are all cultivated varieties. Those are all selected by man, developed by man, and now cultivated by man. So they're cultivated varieties. In fact, you would never find those in the wild. They don't exist in the wild. They're created by us. So this is our mystery plant. If you recognize it, our mystery genus, I should say, give us a call. It also has a common name for the whole group, too. So if you know what these are, give me a call and take a guess. See, here they are. And you can see they're pretty interesting. They grow in clumps. They have bright red flowers when they bloom. They're really cool. And all you have to do is mist them with a little water because they don't grow in soil. And they get bigger and bigger and make big clumps. Really quite well suited for Southern California because they're actually pretty drought tolerant. And all you have to do is get them a little wet occasionally. A lot of people miss them daily, but that's not very much water. It's not like they're water hogs. They're not like ferns and azaleas and things like that that take a lot of water. Roses take a little bit of water too. Grass, of course, is the biggest water hog there is. So now, last week I was also talking about what you should be doing in your garden right now. And let's go over that a little bit. It is officially winter, although today we'll be in the 80s in the inland valleys across Southern California, and probably in the 70s along the beach. It's a very warm day, very dry, and rain is predicted for next week. And let's hope it rains and rains and rains, because we desperately need water in California. And I just really appreciate a little bit of winter instead of having it feel like summer in January, and I get tired of that. Plus, I grow a lot of fruit trees, stone fruits, and if it doesn't get cold enough, they don't bloom very well. So, what should you be doing in your garden? Well, it's always time, you know, this time of year is to start planning your summer vegetable garden. If you want to grow tomatoes, peppers, eggplant, maybe squash, corn, potatoes, beans. There's lots of stuff to grow in the summer, and a lot more stuff that you can select from for summer vegetable than your winter vegetable garden. In Southern California, we can grow a winter vegetable garden. Usually you want to start it in the early fall, about mid-September or into October. Right in there is the best time to plant. And we grow things like peas, head lettuce, broccoli, any of the cold crops. So broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, and then, herbs are kind of year-round, but cilantro is really best grown in the winter because a lot of those things, as soon as the days get long, they're going to flower. When they flower, they're not so good to eat anymore. Lettuce gets very bitter once it starts to flower. So you want to, pick your leaves before the plant matures when it's young and small and tender. So you can start planting that, picking a spot. You can especially get it weed-free, turn it, rake it out flat. I've talked in the past about a really, really nice way to suppress weeds and kill lawns, actually, is to put out cardboard and cover that with 4 inches of compost. That will kill your lawn if you want to get rid of your lawn, and I encourage you to get rid of your lawn because lawns use a tremendous amount of water. And they don't serve much of a purpose, especially in the front of your house where you never use it. It's not like you're going to have people standing on it during a party in your front yard. So generally, lawns in your front, you walk by them in the morning, you walk by them in the evening, and that's it. And then you have to mow them, you have to water them, you have to control the pests, you have to fertilize them. They're more work than you think if you want to take care of it nicely. And then they gobble up water. They just are the biggest water hog there is in a garden, and it's much nicer to have a drought tolerant type of ground cover and assorted shrubs that only need to be watered maybe every 4 weeks or every 2 weeks in the summer. You don't have to mow them. It'll save you money in water. It saves you money having people mow it. And it's just really a much more interesting garden than just a bunch of grass. You can grow aloes and agaves and cactus and various, drought-tolerant trees. It's much more interesting garden rather than just a plain old green blob. So if you have a spot you want to grow a vegetable garden, you want to start getting it ready because planting is coming up. About mid-March, March 15th or so, is your earliest that you normally plant vegetable gardens, although tomatoes, a lot of people plant tomatoes in February, and if we have a warm February, you could be picking tomatoes by the end of May, and I did last year. I got my tomatoes in February, which is very early for me, and I've always been a little pessimistic about planting that early, because normally we have cold. It's cold at night, and the plants just sit there, and they don't grow much, and the ones you plant on March 15th do just as well as the ones you planted on February 15th, and you're picking tomatoes off of them at the same time, usually in June. But last year we had a very warm February and I got them in early and they just took off because of the heat we were having. And plants really respond to heat tremendously. Now, so you can put down the cardboard, cover it with a bunch of mulch and suppress the weeds, and then you'll be ready to plant in 4 to 8 weeks. you want to mix in a lot of compost to the soil. The general recipe or protocol would be to put down about 4 inches of compost, turn that into a depth of about 4 inches, so you have a mixture of 50% compost and 50% soil. Very light mix, and that's what vegetables do really well in, because you want a very high organic level. You can also put in a pre-plant fertilizer. If you want to be organic, you can use non-chemical fertilizers. You can use cottonseed meal, blood meal, bone meal, kelp meal, things like that. You can get certified organic fertilizers. They're a little more expensive. Or, you know, if you're not tied to being organic, you can use the standard fertilizers, things that use for their nitrogen source, ammonium sulfate, calcium nitrate, urea, things like that. And they're fine, but you have to be a little more careful with them because they're soluble forms of nitrogen. It's easier to burn. You just have to be a little more careful. It's very beneficial to take that fertilizer with those, nitrogen salts and use half the label rate twice as often. And then you're going to get the same kind of effect you get with the non-soluble nitrogen sources, which give you a slow, continuous feed of nitrogen rather than peaks and crashes, peak and crash. Every time you fertilize with ammonium sulfate, it goes up, then it comes down. It goes up, and then it comes down. So you can avoid that by splitting your applications in half and doing it twice as often. Now, last week, I was at a nursery, an organic nursery, that had some problems with some of their plant materials. Now, the nursery is called Two Dog Organic Nursery. They sell their plants mostly at two farmers markets, one in La Cañada, and I forget where the other one is, but it's called Two Dog Organic Nursery. Everything they sell is organic. They're organic certified nursery, and they have their niche, and it's really a very small nursery, but they had a problem. They called me up, and they said they had a lot of plant failures, especially the lettuce that they were growing. Almost everything grows is edible, so they sell, you know, everything in mostly 4-inch pots, lettuce, cabbages, broccoli, you know, all vegetable materials for the most part, peas. They're just starting now to seed in their tomatoes and peppers. But they had a lot of problems in the fall with a lot of the lettuce they had grown. And a lot of it didn't do well, and it wasn't really sellable. So I went over and took a look at it. And because we're talking about insects today, and we're going to get into the insects in a minute, let's take a look at this. Now, normally, when they would grow this, and they grow their lettuce from seed, normally when they would have a 4-inch pot like this with lettuce, within 4 weeks, you have big, healthy lettuce plant. Well, that didn't happen. They were stunted. They didn't grow well. They suspected they had viruses. I didn't see any real symptoms of viruses, but I do see a lot of symptoms of insects feeding on the plants. Now, if you look at the back of this leaf here, you can, I don't know how well you can see it, but it's been fed on a lot. It's got black speckles all over it. That's mostly from aphid feeding. So you see this leaf right here, it's turned brown, and it's way too young a leaf to have died. And this is all speckled. So these plants were fed on pretty heavily by either aphids, most likely aphids, but perhaps they also got some mites. I did collect a lot of the plant material from their garden, or from their nursery, and we found a handful of different insects on here. Now, the thing about this, now I really want to take a look at the back of this leaf here, if I can show it to you right here. I don't know if you can see it, but or this one here. Let's spin this and see this. This has little black speckles all over it. It's been fed on heavily by insects. And this is an important point to make, especially if you at home want to grow from seed. Seedlings are very tender, delicate little plants. Anything that is adversely affects them can really stunt them and damage them. And so that's why a lot of people don't grow from seed, because you can have a lot of problems growing from seed. Although generally, it's not that hard. It's not like it's impossible, and it's a lot of fun to grow from seed. I like to grow from seed. But you need to protect very young, small plants from insect feeding. If you don't, it's going to really screw them up. Now, if you get a big plant that's grown up and healthy and vigorous, and it gets some insects on it, it's not going to hurt it very much, unless it gets heavily infested. But a little tiny seedling that gets fed on, and it doesn't have to be that many insects, it can stunt it and cause it not to grow very well. especially when it's young. And now for a nursery, that's really bad because they need to grow things quickly and get them sold. So they want it up and out the door in 4 to 6 weeks, or maybe at the most 8 weeks. They can't sit around and wait for a stunted plant to recover. So I think the major problem they had was not controlling their sucking insects. And we're going to talk about that more in depth. Here's another little pot with some more. And of course, they don't use broad spectrum insecticides, but there's some really good things to use to control these sucking insects that are allowed in organic food production. Oils, horticultural oils, soaps. You can just use dishwashing soap at home, but a nursery, of course, is required to use registered pesticides. So they can buy insecticidal soap, safer insecticidal soap. And we'll talk about more about those products next week, actually. Today, we're going to talk mostly about insects. But if you look at this one, it's got the same kind of problems. You can see a lot of evidence of feeding. See these little white spots here? That's all feeding, where the sucking insect has sucked the juices out of the leaf at that spot. And then here's a brown leaf that shriveled up because it got fed on heavily. And the backs of these leaves all show damage from feeding. And so it stunted these plants, and they did quite poorly. So if you do want to grow from seed, protect your seedlings. And like I said, you can use oils and soaps, and they're non-toxic and have no real adverse effects in the environment. Now, the other problem they did have, of course, was a little powdery mildew. Maybe we'll talk about that later. These are carrots, and I don't know if you're going to see it, but when I would tap this, there were a lot of very tiny, tiny flies that came out of there. Now, I thought they were going to be fungus gnats. They weren't. They were midges. But they may be doing the same thing. So anyway, you do need to suppress a lot of your insects that feed on plants when you're growing seedlings, or it can stunt the seedlings and really damage them. Now, I also grow a couple little plants just as house plants for fun, and I'll show you this one here. These are syngoniums, and this one was looking really good until I left it out, and it got damaged. And take a look at the damage. Let's go to the overhead, and I'll show you the damage on this. And now, this one is a little washed out. If we compare it to this one, if I turn it, you can see this has better color on the undersides of the leaves. There's a nice color. The leaves are in much better condition. This one was in a much warmer location at my house. This one, though, was out in the backyard where it got exposed to a lot of cold night air. And we had a few nights that got down into the 30s, especially right around New Year's Eve. And you can see what the cold night, it doesn't freeze. It got down to 36 probably. And this plant is very sensitive. This is called a syngonium. This particular one is called a butterfly syngonium. And you can see it can't take the cold. This is all cold damage. All this damage to these leaves. See this leaf here? See how badly kind of wilted and poor color and looking really poor? Well, this is just from being outside in the cold. And this is a house plant, so generally you would have this indoors and this wouldn't happen to it, but I had it outdoors. Part of the problem is I have so many darn plants that I don't have space for them all indoors. And of course, to kind of rejuvenate this plant, you just pluck off all these damaged leaves. And don't be shy, just pull them off. They're not doing any good anymore. Give it a little fertilizer. You can use a conventional fertilizer. You could use cottonseed meal or blood meal, but just a little bit. You don't want to fertilize and burn them. But if I just pull off a lot of these leaves, like I'm doing right now, just because they're damaged and they look bad, this will just make the plant look a lot better. Let's see if there's another one. Now, that's most of the damaged leaves. Maybe I'll take this one off too. And now it looks a little better. And now keep it warm. Don't expose it to those cold nights again, although we've had very warm nights lately. So anyway, that'll just make it look a little better right off the bat. Getting rid of the damaged leaves. Give a little fertilizer. Maybe move it up into a larger pot with some fresh potting mix, although this got into this pot just about, 3 or 4 months ago anyway. Anyway, so that's cold damage. So if you have houseplants and you're trying to grow them outdoors and they get damaged, then it's very likely that it's just the cold nights, especially. Now, if it had gotten below 32 degrees, it probably would have killed that plant. It would have just died. But here are all these leaves I pulled off of it because I like to make a mess. Let's just push these over here. Now, before we move on and talk about insects, I've got a lot of seeds, and I'm just going to kind of talk briefly about some of these seeds, because now generally you do want to have fresh seeds. You don't want to use seeds that are really old. I'll keep seeds for 2 years at the most. Your germination rate is going to go down. You need to store them where it's cool and dry. And normally in a pack of seed, there's more seed than you can grow. So if you have a neighbor who likes to garden, maybe you know you can buy a pack of seed, they buy a pack of seed, and you split the seeds. So if you have friends who garden, then you can share seeds, and because generally there's too many seeds in here for one garden. I mean, what are you going to do with 30 cucumber plants? So this is cucumber. It was $1.35. And let's go. Now, cucumber is a summer crop, but if you want to get a head start, you could start these in 4-inch pots right about now. And as soon as they come up and they're getting bigger, then you could probably put them out by about the end of February. Usually, but again, March 15th is a good kind of a cutoff date. But if you're planting a summer vegetable garden and you want to grow from seed, you generally start your seeds near the end of February, I mean, either end of January or in February, so that they'll be big enough to be transplanted in March. So here's cucumber, basil. Let's go to the overhead and I'll just go through here. Melons, it's, here's your cucumber, but it's only $1.35. Well, that's great price to grow all the cucumbers you could eat. Basil, I love to grow basil. Every summer is one of my favorite plants to grow. I love to make pesto. I use it in a lot of dishes. Let's talk a little about melons. Melons are one of the plants that take the longest to mature and develop their fruit. So you do always want to, if you're going to grow melons, if you're going to grow cantaloupes or muskmelon or honeydew or watermelon, you want to get them in as early as possible so that you can be harvesting before the end of the summer. If you get them in late, and on the back of the packet, it will tell you how deep to plant them, the spacing, what time of the year to plant them, all that kind of stuff. And it says, this is Hale's Best Jumbo, an early producer, popular for years in home gardens, about 6.5 inches in diameter. This melon has a thick, sweet salmon orange flesh with rich aromatic flavor. It says, start seeds indoors 4 weeks before planting outdoors. Take care not to disturb roots when transplanting. You can sow in six seeds over a hill 9 to 12 inches tall and 2 feet across. When plants are 3 inches tall, thin to three plants per hill. And I usually plant in hills, and I usually do three plants per hill. But it says, it usually gives days to harvest. And I'm surprised it doesn't have that on the back here. Because usually it'll be 90 days, or 100 days, or 140 days. But melons are often well over 100 days. A short crop would be something under 100 days, like 80, 90, 70, something like that. But melons are often, days to harvest, 85. That's actually very short for a melon, very short. Most melons are over 100 days. Let's take a look at something else. Now, I grew a lot of sunflowers last year, and I'm going to start a lot more sunflowers. I'm going to start some Shasta daisies. Here's a gray zucchini squash, really fun to grow. You can grow leaf lettuce year-round, so here's a couple of leaf lettuce packets. And what's this, 269 and 229, enough lettuce to grow for several years. And then if you want to grow some wild seed, there's all sorts of wild seeds. And now's a good time to spread any wild flower seeds. Red poppy, that would be really fun to grow. And then you can still, of course, try and grow some of the winter materials, although it is time to start looking to summer. So that's my little talk about seed. I like to grow from seed, but protect your seedlings from any insect pests. They're disproportionately damaged compared to mature plants. So let's start talking a little bit about the insects, which is really the main thrust of today's lecture. Insects are probably one of the most fascinating groups of animals that you could ever study. And insects are a class within a group called arthropods. Arthropod means jointed skeleton. And so they have an ectoskeleton. Their skeleton's on the outside of their body. Ours is on the inside of our body. And it's made out of chitin, which is actually a sugar that is used in a variety of organisms. They have a three-part body. They have a head, a thorax, and an abdomen. They have three pairs of jointed legs. So that means they have six legs. That's very important. If an organism has 8 legs, it's not an insect. It's an arachnid. It's either a spider, a mite, or a tick. Well, maybe there's more, but those are the 3 that I'm familiar with. So that really defines insects. They have 6 legs. They have compound eyes and 2 antennae, and typically they have wings and they fly, although there are insects that don't fly. They are clearly among the most diverse of animals on the planet and include more than 1 million described species, and that's probably out of date. There's probably well over 1 million described species now. They represent more than half of all known living organisms. They are mostly solitary, but some insects live in colonies, like bees, ants, and termites. So that colonial behavior is unique to those groups, but most insects really aren't a colony. They're really just individuals. Let's talk about our first group of insects that feed on plants, and those are aphids. Let's bring up our first picture of aphids. Aphids are one of the most destructive insects on crops for a variety of reasons. On their own, they can damage the crop, especially young, sensitive, tiny plants. These are aphids on a rosebud. And if you ever grow roses in the spring, you'll get these all over your rose. There are probably some mature ones and some larval forms in here. Aphids go by a couple different names. They're also called plant lice, and in Britain they call them green flies. Aphids are among the most destructive insect pests on cultivated plants. There are about 4,400 species in 10 families. Many aphid species are monophagous, which means they feed on only one species of plant. There are others across many families, like the green peach aphid, feed on hundreds of plant species. So you've got, well, with 4,400 species, you would expect quite a diversity in their biology. They passively feed on sap in the phloem in plants, as do their fellow members of Hemiptera, such as scale and cicadas. And plants contain low densities of nitrogen compounds needed for building proteins. This requires aphids to consume excess sap to satisfy the nutritional requirements. So you can see them feeding on this plant. So we're starting with sucking insects, because we can, for a gardener, it kind of simplifies things to separate insects on how they feed. They can either be sucking insects or they can be chewing insects. There are also wood-boring insects, and those are kind of completely in another category. But for, you know, especially for vegetables and fruit trees, well, fruit trees, trees and shrubs will get wood-boring insects, but usually don't get a lot of wood borers in a vegetable because they don't really have wood. But the sucking insects, how do they feed? They have a long, narrow mouth part called a proboscis. They stick it into the plant and go, and suck the phloem, the sugary material, out of the phloem. What is phloem? Well, there are 2 types of vascular tissue in plants. One is called xylem, which is the wood of trees and shrubs, and it moves water. Xylem is, you can think of it as microscopic tubes that have a continuous flow of water from the roots all the way up and through the shoots to the ends of the leaves. It's a continuous column of water in these tiny, tiny, almost microscopic tubes. That's called xylem. The other vascular tissue is called phloem. Now, phloem occurs just underneath the epidermis, or the bark of a tree, the epidermis, or, you know, the outer covering on stems. And phloem contains the products of photosynthesis, the sugars. Photosynthesis produces sugar, a variety of different kinds of sugar. It is moved from where it's made in the leaves to where it needs to be used in the plant. And that's how phloem. So phloem can go either direction. Xylem, the water only goes from the roots up to the shoots. It's one-way movement. Phloem can go from the leaves down into the roots, and it does, because it has to feed the roots so they can grow. Anywhere where you have a growing point, the phloem has to bring the food to it so it has the food, the energy to grow. So where are these growing points? And those growing points are called meristems. Buds, you know, that make new leaves or make flowers, the tips of roots, And then just underneath the bark where you have what's called the vascular cambium. That's also a meristematic tissue. So wherever the plant is growing, the phloem is bringing the food. In big trees, or in trees in general, in the spring, when they start to grow their new leaves, the phloem starts moving the sugars up into the tree, and it's when the sap starts to flow. Have you ever heard that phrase, the sap is starting to flow? That happens in the spring. It's mobilizing, the plant or the tree is mobilizing stored food reserves and moving it up to the growing points in the canopy to grow new leaves. The leaves make a whole bunch of food. It starts flowing down into the trunk and in the branches and into the roots for the tree or the shrub to save that as energy for next year's growth. So aphids poke their mouthparts into the phloem and don't even have to really suck. It just flows through them, and they need a lot of it in order to get enough nitrogen to make protein. There's not a lot of nitrogen in there. It's mostly sugar. And it drips off their rear end as honeydew, and it's sticky. And so one of the ways you can tell you have a sucking insect infestation in a tree is when you notice that there's sticky honeydew all over the leaves near the bottom of the plant, because they're up at the top and it's dripping down on the lower leaves. As after a little while, that honeydew will be colonized by mold fungi, and they're usually black, and we call it sooty mold. If you see black all over a leaf and you can just wipe it off with your finger and it's green underneath, that's sooty mold, and it's telling you you have a sucking insect infestation. One of the most common of all sucking insects, of course, are aphids. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is the rose aphid, and see if there's more about aphids. Now, bring this up full screen. This is the rose aphid. This is heavy infestation. This needs to be controlled. If you only have a couple aphids, you can wait a little while and see if other beneficial insects will eat them and bring them under control. But if you have this many, and they're almost uncountable, you need to spray this with something to kill these aphids. You can actually just use a strong stream of water. If you knock this guy off, and he's got his mouth part stuck in here, it will break. And that's it. That one will never eat again. They are delicate little insects. They're actually easily killed. The other thing about aphids and a lot of the sucking insects is that ants farm them just the way we farm cows in a way. They collect that honeydew that drips off their rear end. And so aphids are a major source of food for ants, particularly in Southern California, the Argentine ant, which is the little black ants that you'll see walking up the trunks of trees. And if you see Argentine ants going up into plants, up into bushes or trees, that also tells you you have sucking insects, because they're going up there for a reason. They're going up there to collect the honeydew. Let's take a look at our next picture, and you'll see ants tending aphids. And they can disrupt, bring this up full screen. So I don't think these are actual Argentine ants, but here are the aphids, and here are the ants that are collecting the honeydew. And they will protect these from predators. They will protect them from ladybug beetles and from lacewings and from pirate bugs, because they're collecting food. They want them to sit there and feed on the plant. So generally, it helps if you're trying to control aphids or other sucking insects to also control your ants. Now let's move on to our next group of sucking insects, which are mealybugs. And let's take a look at our next picture, which I believe is the two-tailed mealybug. This is the long-tailed mealybug, and here's the long tail. And mealybugs are actually a type of scale insect. They're in the group with the other scale insects, but they don't really secrete a hard covering. A lot of scale insects will be feeding right here, and then they secrete a hard covering over themselves that protects them. Mealybugs don't do that. They're often white and fluffy on the backs of leaves, and this is an adult. If you see this somewhere down on the stem, and there's white fluffy stuff on the backs of house plants or on the backs of plants out in your garden, you have mealybugs. Mealybug is the most common name of insects in the Pseudococcidae, a family of unarmored scale insects. So these are not armored scales. They are found in moist, warm climates. Of course, they're ubiquitous now in throughout California, and a good cold in the winter will probably knock them down, but they're never going to eradicate or get rid of them. They always come back in the spring. I just had to clean up some of my orchids that always get mealybug all over them. So they are sexually dimorphic, meaning that the sexes have distinct morphological differences, so the female will be much larger than the male. They are hemiptera. They do not undergo complete metamorphosis. So hemiptera is the order for sucking insects within the class Insecta. So there are no clear larval, pupal, or adult stages. So little larvae look like adults, but they're not sexually mature. Mealybug females feed on plant sap, normally in roots or on the crevices of leaves. They attach themselves to the plant and secrete a powdery wax layer, therefore calling mealybugs, used for protection while they suck the plant juices. The males, on the other hand, are short-lived as they do not feed at all as adults and only live to fertilize the females, which obviously is wholly unfair by nature. And the most serious pests are mealybugs that feed on citrus. Other species that are particularly damaging, sugarcane, you find them on sugarcane, grapes, pineapple, coffee, cassava, ferns, cacti, gardenias, and orchids. And in fact, mealybugs are the number one pest I have on my orchids. Mealybugs only tend to be serious pests in the presence of ants because the ants protect them from predators and parasites. So, and I want to just mention that aphids, what we were talking about aphids a second ago, aphids are the number one vector for viruses. Most viruses are vectored by insects. Now, some viruses are mechanically transmissible. But when you talk about the viruses that get into your vegetable garden, most of those are getting there by aphids. And so there's a couple of strategies for dealing with viruses. One of the main strategies is to prevent infection until the plants are up and full size and producing whatever you want to eat from them. If you grow a pepper plant and you get it up real big and it's covered with peppers and then it gets infected, it's not going to affect the yield very much. You're going to get lots of peppers and your crop you'll be very happy with your crop. If you have a little tiny pepper, about this big, a little seedling, and an aphid lands on it and feeds on it and infects it with a virus, it may be stunted, it may be twisted and contorted, it may not get much bigger than that, and you may not get very many peppers at all. It may grow up and get a little bigger and make small fruit that's twisted and contorted. So when a plant gets infected by a virus is very important, especially for vegetable production. You want to delay that as long as possible. So you've got to control those aphids in the early spring and try and get your plants up. And now, normally there's not a whole lot of aphids in the early spring. Their populations can really explode exponentially because the females, when they lay their eggs, they don't have to mate. It's called parthenogenesis. They can reproduce without being, without sex, without mating. Their eggs just hatch and then you just have another female. The only way you get males though would be a mating. So those are mealybugs. Now let's take a look at some more pictures of mealybugs. This next one is called the Taxus mealybug. Let's bring that picture up. And you get an idea what mealybugs look like. This next one is the citrus mealybug. Let's take a look at that one. And here you can see what looks an awful lot like an Argentine ant, but it probably isn't. Tending these citrus mealybugs. So if you're growing citrus, you definitely want to keep these suppressed. And as I've said many times, soaps and oils do quite a good job. Excuse me. Let's take a look at our next picture, and this is an important distinction. Now mealybugs tend to just sit there. They've got their mouth part. Let's take a look. Do we have a number seven? No, we skipped a picture. Hopefully we can get back to it. There we go. That looks like a mealybug. But if you saw this, and it looks like there's a whole bunch of scale insects all over this, not aphids, but this right here looks like a mealybug, but it's not. It's actually called the mealybug destroyer. And that's the larval form of a beetle that is in the same group as the ladybug beetles. And both the adult beetle and this larval form, the mealybug destroyer, eat aphids and mealybugs and anything they can bump into, probably. And how can you tell the difference? Well, mealybugs don't move. They just sit there. Even if you bump them, they'll barely take a step. This guy will go boop, 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 and walk right down the thing looking for its food. Predators move around a lot. Predaceous insects are looking for something to eat. So they walk around fairly quickly. They don't run around fast, but they are moving, and they're moving fairly rapidly. And others, like aphids, they don't move at all. They're just sitting there feeding, and they're just going to, and you have to disturb them to get them to move. And even then, they don't move very much. And I had a lady call me up to the lab and said, "Oh, I've got these strange insects all over my plant. And what are they?" And we figured out that it was this. It was the mealybug destroyer. And I said, "Oh, those are beneficial, so you don't need to spray those." She goes, "Oh, I already sprayed them." Well, you just killed a beneficial insect in your garden for no reason at all. So you wasted your money on the spray, you wasted your time spraying, and now you're probably going to have a more severe insect infestation of the ones you don't want. So correct identification of your pest is absolutely critical. If you don't know what you're spraying, you don't know if what you're doing is good, bad, or benign. So you really have to think about that. So we talked about mealybugs. Let's talk about scale insects. Now, scale insects are some of the most difficult insects to control because of the armored scales. There are soft scales and there are armored scales, and there are unarmored scales, and mealybugs are unarmored, and so they're not so hard to control. But the armored scales, and let's bring up our next picture that we just saw a second ago. This is barnacle scale, and this is actually a native scale that occurs often on native plants. I've found this a number of times up in the chaparral on things like toyon or ceanothus, which are two common chaparral plants. This is called barnacle scale, and it's heavy infestation. And the insect is actually under this. This is the covering. What you see here is called the integument. And the insect is underneath here. So they've made this shelter, and the insect is here. And this is just a protective covering right in here. And so if you spray this with an oil or a soap, it won't do anything because it doesn't get to the insect. Oils and soaps are contact insecticides. You have to spray them directly on the insect. Now let's take a look at this next picture. And some of the scales can be fairly host specific, so you don't necessarily get this barnacle scale on other non-native plants. I've never seen it on anything but on natives. But this next one is cycad scale. So this is a cycas revoluta, or a sago palm. And this is all scale. All these are scale insects all over the place. This is a heavy infestation. That's a lot of them. And what'll happen is wherever they're feeding, you'll get a yellow spot on the other side of the leaf. And it makes your plant look very poor. It probably doesn't help it grow at all either. It may stunt it a little, you might not notice it, but you certainly don't want a heavy infestation of scale insects on your cycads. Generally for scale insects, you have to use a more potent insecticide. So you would have to use a broad spectrum insecticide that's not organic, something like 7, or malathion, or orthene, which is a horribly stinky stuff that I hate to use. But you need to get on it as soon as you see the problem. If you see on the tops of your leaves that you got all these yellow dots, flip it over, see if there's something feeding on the underside of that leaf. Almost certainly there will be. And you need to spray to control that. If you spray with oils and soaps, you can kill what's called the crawler sage for scale insects. You've got the adult underneath the integument that's protected from the environment, but eventually it's filled with eggs under there. And all those eggs will hatch, and the little tiny larval forms of the scale insects will start walking around. When they're doing that, they can be killed quite easily with soaps and oils. There's another group called pyrethrins or pyrethroids, which are synthetic pyrethrins. And if you want to just use soaps and oils, you're going to have to spray frequently to try and kill the crawlers. Now, you don't know when the crawlers are going to be there unless you're constantly monitoring the plant. So you'd have to check the plant almost daily. And then you'd have to notice the crawlers and then spray. Well, that's probably not very practical. So you're going to have to, if you don't want to use broad-spectrum, non-organic, insecticides, then you're going to have to use oils and soaps and pyrethrins. Now, if you use an oil and a pyrethrin, you can suppress scale, but you won't really clean it up. The other option, if this is a small plant, is just to physically remove them. You can take a like cotton and dip it in a little bit of alcohol, maybe a 10% isopropyl alcohol, and just wipe them off the back of the leaf. You have to scrape them off. That's very time consuming and very, you know, real pain. If you've got a lot of plants, it's really impossible. But if you had one small plant, you could do that. So it has its practicality. But let's talk a little bit more about scales. They are called, of course, in the order Hemiptera, and classified in the superfamily Coccidae. There are about 8,000 species of scale insects. Scale insects vary dramatically in their appearance, from very small organisms, 1 to 2 millimeters, that occur under wax covers, to shiny pearl-like objects, up to 5 millimeters, to creatures covered with mealy wax. Adult female scales are almost always immobile and permanently attached to the plant they have parasitized, so they don't get up and walk around and move. But you can tell it's scale. You can just scrape it off with your finger. It comes off fairly easily if you just scrape it off and squish it. And then you'll notice that it's sticky and gooey and that was a living insect. Scale insects' waxy covering makes them quite resistant to pesticides, which are only effective against the first instar nymph called the crawler stage. Adult males have wings but never feed and die within a day or two. Again, highly unfair from biology. So that's scale insects. And I have talked to some people over the years about scale insects. And they tell me, especially some of the CDFA quarantine people who are trying to prevent the spread or introduction of exotic pests. And these scales will show up in nurseries. Boy, is it hard to get rid of scales. They are difficult. You can spray and spray and spray, and you come back in 6 months and they're back. So it takes a really tenacious effort to really suppress them and keep them from damaging your garden. Now let's talk a little bit about whiteflies. We have some more pictures of scale. There's a date scale that you really need to see if you have any palm trees. This is the red date scale. Bring that up full screen. Now this scale here's the scale. It gets in between the folds of the leaves, right in here. Gets way in here. Very difficult to control. A lot of people, when they're controlling scale insects, use systemic insecticides because they can be so difficult to control. And here, let's take a look at number 11, and this is a really interesting scale. This is called cochineal scale, and this occurs almost exclusively on opuntia or beaver tail or prickly pear cactus. So those are native cactus. Opuntia is native to California, and this scale insect is native to California. It's white and fluffy. It's actually a scale insect. It's called cochineal. When you squish it, it is bright red, and it was used as a dye to dye clothing for a long time, and there was a whole industry of people collecting this off of Puntia around 1900. Well, with the introduction of synthetic dyes, that whole industry died out, but we still have cochineal scale. Let's take a look at the next picture, and you can see how heavy it can infest a Puntia. This is a Puntia that's just thoroughly covered with cochineal scale. You can wash this off with a strong stream of water, with a hose. This is not that hard to control. You can actually just wash it off. But it probably would be better to also hit it with either an oil or a soap or even a pyrethrin, and then do some repeat applications. I often recommend treating once a week for 3 weeks when you have insect infestations that are causing problems on your plant. The next group we're going to talk about is our whiteflies. But before we talk about whiteflies, it's the top of the hour, and we like to have a little station break to remind you that you're watching Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from Cal State Dominguez Hills in Carson. We're going to go to that station break in a minute, but I just want to mention again a little bit about scale and cochineals. Cochineal is really fun. If you have some young children and you like to do some kind of, you know, interesting things with them, go find some opuntia with the scales, collect it, put it on something that you can collect it, and then get some white yarn and then put the scale into the water and then let it boil and then dip the yarn in there and you will dye it pink. pink or red, or if it depends on how much scale you put in there. It's a fun thing to do. It's just, you know, and it kind of connects you back to a time before synthetic dyes, and it's just interesting. It's kind of a fun thing to do. So just a suggestion to use cochineal scale to dye some white yarn, and your kids might get a kick out of that. Let's go to our station break and remind you, you're watching Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from Cal State University, Dominguez Hills.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
My name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, my name is Leroy Harding. I'm a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin sauce is ridiculous.
The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the literal.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name's Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the garden show that's all about gardens, what you grow in them, how you grow them, what you select, controlling the pests, how to prune, how to fertilize, how to water, kind of a general course on how to take care of your garden. Give us a call where there are a live broadcast, 1-800-339-1193. If you have a question about your garden, if there's a plant material you want to grow, if you had a tree die, if you had problems, or if you just want to rub it in that you had a great garden and you don't have any problems, give us a call. We're talking about insects today, and we just finished talking up about aphids, and then we talked about mealybug, and we talked about scale, and those are all sucking insects. They don't chew. They're not like grasshoppers and beetles and caterpillars. They suck. And they suck on many levels. But next one we want to talk about are whiteflies. And whiteflies are also sucking insects. And let's talk about them a little bit. And let's bring up a picture of some whitefly. This is the black pupal stage on what looks like, could be an oak leaf for that matter. But this is whitefly. There's only one family of whiteflies. They are small hemipterans, so they're in the Hemiptera order. There are about 1,550 species within the family. The feeding damage can cause economic losses. It is the ability of white flies to transmit or spread viruses that has had the widest impact on global food production. And in fact, they are well known for spreading viruses into lettuce crops. The feeding damage alone can cause economic losses. It is the ability of white flies to transmit or spread viruses that has had the widest impact. The tomato yellow leaf curl virus was discovered in the USA in 1997 in Florida. This plant disease is the worst viral disease of tomato and is transmitted by the whitefly Bemisia argentinifolii. So let's take a look at some pictures of whitefly. We see this picture here. This next one is the giant whitefly. And whiteflies have some really unique things they do. Here are the adult whiteflies, and they look like they are flies. They're not in the Diptera order, the fly order. But this particular one gets on hibiscus, and when it was first introduced, it spread like wildfire. Let's take a look at the next picture, and you might recognize this a little better from this next picture. And then we'll look at some more whiteflies in a second. Let's see if we have the next picture. But these long threads you see here are actually wax tendrils that are made by the nymphs or the larval forms. And it'll hang down. This is the giant whitefly. You see it most commonly on hibiscus. And it looks like it's growing a beard. And wherever whiteflies walk, they leave a trail of wax. And let's see do we have that next picture? If not, we can go to the caller. But the next picture, oh, here it is. This is the giant whitefly on the back of a hibiscus leaf. And all these little white filaments you see here are wax tendrils produced by the larva, not the adults. Now, if you shake the leaf, these little whiteflies will fly all over the place. They just, millions of them. And they're very waxy, and so they're also very difficult to control. And we'll look at a few other whiteflies here in a second, but I see we have a caller. So let's go to our first caller of the day. Terry calling from Pasadena. You're on the air. Terry, are you there?
I'm ladybugs.
Oh, could you say that again? I missed your question.
I wanted to buy some ladybugs to control my aphids and my plants. Is that something something I could do?
Well,
I should do?
Aphids are very beneficial. The problem, not aphids, ladybugs, beetles, do eat aphids, but they'll eat anything. And so we call them generalists. Things like lacewings, ladybugs, pirate bugs, They all are, they're all beneficial, and they all eat other insects, so they're wonderful to keep around, but they will not bring your aphid population under control. They tend to just fly away. They disperse, and that's their natural habitat. If you go buy a little, I've seen them often in the nurseries, little plastic containers filled with ladybug beetles. And you take them home and put them in your backyard, and within a few hours, you're lucky to have even a few of them left in your garden. Now, so I don't think they are worth the expense. They charge a lot of money for them, in my opinion. You're much better off just using soapy water, or you can buy insecticidal soap, or you can use one of the oil products in the spring, and spraying once a week for 3 weeks. That will get rid of your aphids. And by using soft pesticides like oils and soaps, you will also not wipe out all the beneficials. Now, the other option is, particularly on things like roses, you can just wash the aphids off with a strong stream of water. If they're covering a bud or they're covering the new growth, just take the hose and put your thumb over it and spray them off. If you only have a few plants, that's doable. If you've got 100 roses, that's not so doable. And then you're going to have to spray. If you've got a large garden and a lot of plants, you can't just wash them all off. Or if you've got big, huge plants covered with aphids, you probably can't wash them off either. But washing off does work because water hits them and it knocks them off the plant, it breaks their mouth because it's stuck in the plant. And then once their mouth breaks, they'll never feed again. And once they hit the ground, there's a bunch of insects down there that'll eat them. So.
Oh, okay.
But the ladybug, you can encourage them by using soft pesticides and keeping a lot of beneficials alive in your garden by not using broad-spectrum insecticides, by using oils and soaps that are contact materials, and you only spray it on the plant you want to control the insect pest. You know, you don't spray your whole garden with, you know, you're wasting your product if you're spraying plants that don't have pests. So no, I wouldn't recommend buying ladybug beetles. They're already fairly common. You'd have to do something like cage them, put a tarp or a cage over the plant, and then release the beetles underneath the tarp and keep them there and get them to lay eggs there. If they lay eggs and you get larvae, the larvae they can't fly, they don't have wings. The larvae will stay on the plant until they pupate and turn into adults and go away, and they'll eat a lot of ladybugs. But when, I'm not ladybugs, I keep saying the wrong words. The larvae for the ladybugs will eat a lot of aphids. But when
that would be good.
But you got to get the ladybug beetles to stay there long enough to lay the eggs, and that's kind of a challenge. I don't buy them, and I don't recommend people buy them.
Okay. Thank you for all that information. It really helped me.
Okay.
Make a decision.
Thank you for calling in and watching the show. You know, you often see a lot of these beneficial insects being sold. And they are beneficial insects, and they do eat other insects. But generalists, insects that will eat anything, like praying mantis, ladybug beetles, pirate bugs, lacewings, they are not effective biocontrol agents on their own. Now, if you can encourage lots of them and different ones, then you will suppress a lot of your insects. But boy, when you get a heavy infestation on a plant material in your garden, you pretty much are going to need to spray it. Biocontrol has been very successful in some very specific instances. The Vidalia beetle was introduced in the 1890s to control cottony cushiony scale on citrus. The Vidalia beetle only feeds on cottony cushiony scale. It's not a generalist. Within a year of introducing the Vidalia beetle from Australia, cottony cushiony scale was brought under control in California. That's the first instance of using an insect to control a pest insect. And that's the very first time biocontrol was employed to control an agricultural pest, and it worked. But usually what you need is that the beneficial insect only feeds on the pest you're after. Because if it can feed on anything, it'll just disperse in the environment and feed on anything. And then it doesn't bring your pest under control. Might eat a few of them, but it's not going to bring it under satisfactory level of control. So you just have a few on a few. instead of a lot on everything. So generally speaking, they don't work. But if it's cheap and you want to set out a few in your garden in the spring, more power to you. But you're not going to bring your... What I would do is, if you really want to use something like that, is I would spray the aphids with oil or soap, knock them way down, and then release the ladybug beetles, because then, you know, if you spray the ladybug beetles with soapy or water or oil, you can kill them too. So that's my take on that. Let's take a look at some more whiteflies. Here's another picture of whitefly. These are whitefly adults. Bring this up full screen. We lost our picture. Let's bring that up full screen. And so you can see, these are whiteflies. And if you suspect you have whiteflies, just shake the bush or shake the plant, and they'll fly all over the place in these little whiteflies. I once had back in the early 70s when I was mowing lawns and going to junior college, I had an older customer that I took care of her garden, and she would take her rose bushes and shake them. Or maybe it's a different bush, because I usually don't see whitefly much on roses. And she would shake it and have a newspaper that she lit on fire, and she would shake the bush and the whiteflies would start flying in the air, and she would swoop it underneath them and burn them. A little wild, but fairly effective. Let's take a look at our next picture. And this is a whitefly. This is spiraling whitefly. And like I said, wherever they walk, they leave a trail of wax, the adults. So it probably started, it looks like it started here and walked like this. And let's see if I can follow it. And you can see where this whitefly was walking, like that. And maybe even started right in here, and then we did that. So this is whitefly. This, if you see something like this on the back of a leaf, you absolutely know it's whitefly. A lot of times they walk along the edge of the leaf and they ring the edge of the leaf in wax, particularly the giant whitefly. Now, what happened with the giant whitefly that you see on hibiscus? It was introduced sometime in the late 90s and spread rapidly. And every hibiscus you could find in Southern California, on the backs of the leaves, you had these wax tendrils hanging down about 4 inches, 5 inches, and every leaf, and it looked horrible. And a lot of people gave up on hibiscus because it was so heavy. So, in an effort to bring this under control, and I'm not sure, probably from UCR, probably one of the entomology professors from UCR went to Mexico, because this insect, this giant whitefly, is native to Mexico, and looked for the giant whitefly. And it was very hard to find where in its native range, which tells you that it's pretty much under biocontrol there. And he found a wasp that parasitizes the giant whitefly. He brought back that wasp, a little tiny, tiny wasp. It doesn't sting people. It's not like a yellow jacket or a paper wasp or mud daubers, a big wasp that sting people. It's a little tiny, tiny wasp. And it lays its eggs either in the larva or the adults. I'm not exactly sure what phase it parasitizes. But that wasp was introduced. And within about a year, you stop seeing giant whitefly for the most part. Now, you can still find some hibiscus that have giant whitefly. But it's much, much less. The wasp is established in the environment. And it brought the whitefly problem pretty much, the giant whitefly problem, pretty much under control in Southern California. Now, you still get outbreaks of it here and there. That's the way biocontrol is. Biocontrol is not chemical control. If you spray a plant with a broad-spectrum insecticide and you do thorough coverage, you pretty much kill every insect on the bush. Biocontrol doesn't work that way. Biocontrol kills, if it's effective, kills 99% of the bugs. And then you get an equilibrium between the predator and the pest. And that equilibrium should be so low that there's so few of the pests it's not damaging the plant. And that's what you're trying to achieve with biocontrol. Now, there's another group of insect pests called thrips. And let's take a look at our next picture. Thrips, there's a lot of different kinds of thrips. And some of them really are damaging. These are the adult thrips, often described as looking like a little alligator. And this particular one is on spice bush, and they often cause the leaves to be twisted and deformed and curly or galled up. They don't really gall. The next picture is Myoporum thrips. Now, Myoporum is an Australian plant that we grow in Southern California. That we grow a prostrate species, and we grow a full-size shrub, two different species. And you can see this thrip here, and it causes the leaves here. You can see these leaves, they're all twisted and curled and screwed up. And it's very hard to control with just contact insecticides. You almost, if you have Myoporum, and it's very popular along the coast, it doesn't do as well in the inland, at least you don't see it much in the inland valleys. You see it a lot along the coast. And it causes the leaves to be twisted and curled and contorted, and then they defoliate, and if you don't control it, the plant will die. And I've seen a lot of plants die from it already. It's been around now for quite a few years. When this was first observed on Myoporum, the thrip had never been seen before and it had not been described. It was a brand new species to science. And we know, since it only feeds on Myoporum, that it had to be an Australian species. So the thrips were sent to Australia to find out what the species is. The Australian scientists who specialize on thrips had never seen it before, even though it had to be a native from Australia. So it was described. And when you describe a new organism, like an insect or a bird or whatever it is, the description is based on a collection of the organism. So, and that's called the type species. And it can be one single organism. That's the type species. That is preserved and put into a collection, like a collection of insects, a collection of plants, a collection of whatever the organisms is, you know, that you're describing, usually in a museum or on a university campus. And it's the type species. People can come back later and look at it and say, okay, I'm collecting it in New York. The type species is from Australia or it's from here. I'll go and look at that type species and compare it with what I'm seeing to see if they're the same species. The type species for Myoporum thrips was collected in Los Angeles, even though it's an Australian species. And that's not the first time that's happened. There are a number of Australian pests that have been described from collections made in Los Angeles because we grow a lot of Australian plant material. We grow eucalyptus, we grow melaleucas, we grow Myoporum, we grow all sorts of Australian plants. They do quite well here because we have the same climate, at least the Mediterranean part of Australia. And so those insects in their native range are being suppressed. The population is being suppressed by natural enemies that we don't have in California. When the insect is introduced into California and there's lots of plant material for it to feed on and nothing to suppress its population, the populations explode. So this Myoporum thrip was introduced, and within a year or two, it was feeding on every Myoporum. You couldn't find a Myoporum that hadn't been fed on, that wasn't infested. And then within another couple of years, a lot of those Myoporums started dying because they were being defoliated and badly damaged by the insect. In Australia, you never see that many of them because they're being eaten up and parasitized by either small wasp or something's eating them and killing them. So let's see if we have some more thrips. There is another thrip I want to take a look at, and this is the ficus thrips. This is the Indian laurel thrips. Ficus microcarpa is a big tree in the ficus genus, the fig genus, and they get pretty big, and they are used for hedges and street trees. This is probably one of the more common street trees, and they're notorious for breaking sidewalks and lifting pavement. But when the thrip feeds on the leaves, it causes them to be twisted and curled and turned black. So all these here are damaged by the Indian laurel thrips, because this is called Indian laurel, this particular tree, but it's Ficus microcarpa. Some people call it variety nitida or even Ficus nitida, but nitida is not the correct name. So it doesn't hurt the tree very much. It's kind of insignificant, but you often see it. And if you're growing this as a hedge and you're shearing it, if you're coming and cutting the stuff off when you shear, then you'll be removing the damaged foliage anyway. You can control this if you don't like it. And that would not be necessary unless it's heavily infested. Now, let's talk a little bit more thrips. Thrips are tiny, slender insects with fringed wings. Some species of thrips feed on other insects. There are predaceous thrips, and you can actually, those are some of the beneficials you can actually order. They can feed on mites, are considered beneficial, while some feed on fungal spores or pollen. So it's an interesting group. There are about 5,000 species of thrips that have been described. They are small, hemimetabolic insects with a distinctive cigar-shaped body plan, elongate with transversely constricted bodies. They kind of look a little like alligators. So they have incomplete metamorphosis, which is what hemimetabolism means. The rate at which thrips move through their development cycle is highly dependent on environmental conditions, particularly the temperature and nutrient quality of their food source. Over 20 plant-infecting viruses are known to be transmitted by thrips. Now, that's not very many, considered that aphids are the number one vector of viruses, but a lot of these insects can move viruses. Now, let's talk a little bit about beetles. Before we go to beetles, let's talk a little bit about another sucking insect. And they're called sharpshooters. And why are sharpshooters so important? Well, we have our native sharpshooters in California. And let's bring up our first picture of our native sharpshooter. This is the red-headed sharpshooter. And the next one, we'll just go through these fairly quickly. The next one is the green sharpshooter. Let's take a look at that one. They are bullet-shaped insects. Let's take a look at the next one, which is the blue-green sharpshooter. And that one's kind of pretty. Now, historically, sharpshooters were important because they vectored a bacteria that causes disease called Xylella fastidiosa. And Xylella fastidiosa causes scorch diseases, and it causes a disease in grape called Pierce's disease of grape. And then, about 1990, a new sharpshooter was discovered in Southern California that's not native. It's native to Texas all the way to Florida. It's called the glassy-winged sharpshooter. That's our next picture. Let's take a look at the glassy-winged sharpshooter. It's about a third larger than our native sharpshooters. It has a quite distinct pattern. It looks a lot like the smoke tree sharpshooter, which I didn't show you a picture of. Let's take a look at the next picture, which is also the glassy-winged sharpshooter. And at the same time that this sharpshooter showed up, oleanders started dying out in Riverside County, and very soon after, they were diagnosed as being infected with Xylella fastidiosa, and the disease was called oleander leaf scorch. And now, it's called bacterial leaf scorch because it's showing up in so many hosts. It's killing liquid ambers, olives, plums, crepe myrtles, and of course oleanders. It's known in almond for a long time. On the East Coast, it affects maples and oaks. And in grape, it's called Pierce's disease of grape. And in the 1890s, it broke out in Anaheim and wiped out all 45 wine-producing vineyards in the Anaheim area. At the time, it was called Anaheim disease or grape mystery disease. It's fatal. Whenever you have a plant infected with Xylella, it's going to kill it. And this sharpshooter now is the main culprit in our landscapes because this one does quite well in landscapes. And the others I showed you are native sharpshooters, do not do well in landscapes. They are riparian or they are in grasslands and they don't do well. They don't feed in landscapes in a diverse habitat. The glassy-winged sharpshooter will feed on 200 different hosts and so it does quite well in landscapes. And so with the introduction of this sharpshooter and the expansion of the host range for Xylella in Southern California, we are going to lose a lot of trees. We're going to lose a lot of liquid ambers. They're dying now in large numbers. We're going to lose a lot of olives. It's going to be nearly impossible to grow olives commercially in Southern California if you're trying to grow them for olives. They're dying out rather rapidly, and it's quite common to see them infected. So those are the sharpshooters. Now, the biggest order of insects is called Coleoptera, and those are the beetles. And there are a lot of beetles, and beetles can do a lot of damage. And this is our first chewing insect. Everything else we looked at were sucking insects. This is a chewing insect. And so often you won't see the beetle. You'll just see your leaves all chewed up on your plant and the beetles are gone. Or they come out at night and chew and you don't see them during the daytime. So that's a chance. Let's talk a little bit about the group. Of course, the name of the order is called Coleoptera. Now, I didn't talk about this, but there are about 27 orders or so. People disagree. They keep changing around how many orders there are. But there's roughly 27 or so orders of within Insecta, which is a class. The biggest orders are Coleoptera, which are the beetles, Diptera, which are the flies, Hemiptera, which are the sucking insects, and then the butterflies and moths are Lepidoptera. Those are some of the really big orders with hundreds of thousands of species, if not millions of species. And then you got a lot of small orders, but they can be important too. But Diptera are flies, Coleoptera are beetles, Hemiptera are the sucking insects, and Lepidoptera are the moths and butterflies. And then Odonata is another order for dragonflies and damselflies. In an interesting group, but those are all beneficials. Dragonflies and damselflies are all predaceous. They eat other insects. So, Coleoptera, or the beetle order, contains more described species than in any other order in the animal kingdom, constituting about 25% of all known life forms. 40% of all described insect species are beetles. About 350,000 species of beetles are described, but it's believed there's easily a million in existence. They often feed on plants and fungi, break down animal and plant debris, and eat other invertebrates. Certain species are agricultural pests, such as the Colorado potato beetle and the boll weevil. Other species of beetles are important controls of pests. For example, beetles in the family Coconellidae are ladybirds or ladybug beetles, and they eat aphids, scale, and thrips. And we've talked about that. They're generalists. They'll eat anything. Like all insects, beetles' bodies are divided into three sections, the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. Beetles are generally characterized by a particularly hard ectoskeleton and hard forward wings. So they're usually fairly large compared to a lot of other insects. They have mouth parts similar to those of grasshoppers. They have mandibles that chew. Most commonly known are probably the mandibles. Mandibles are a pair of hard, often tooth-like structures that move horizontally to grasp, crush, and cut food or enemies. Let's take a look at our first, the striped cucumber beetle. And this is a particularly damaging beetle that you might see in your vegetable garden, and it can do a lot of damage to your plants. The next one is the tin-lined June beetle. And this one, the grubs feed on the roots of pines, and the adult beetles also feed on pine. They just posed it on this flower. Let's take a look at our next one, which is the green fruit beetle. This one is a native beetle to Southern California, or at least California. It has this metallic blue color on the underside and this dullish green on the top. The larvae feed in mulch piles or in the soil, and they'll be, you know, so they're in mulch, they're in decaying organic matter. And then they have very large grubs, maybe 2 inches long, big white grubs. So if you turn a mulch pile, you'll often find a lot of those white grubs in it. And then in about late spring, they come out and start flying around, and they're pretty big. And you can hear them with this zzz flying around. They're kind of poor flyers. They'll bump into you. They don't do a lot of damage to anything unless you get very large populations, but they will feed on fruit. And this beetle is often confused for the Japanese beetle, although it doesn't look anything like it. People just assume when they see this, they go, oh, that must be a Japanese beetle. We don't have Japanese beetles in California. They don't occur here. They are occasionally found here, but there's no reproducing population of them. They are, you know, the Japanese beetle does occur on the East Coast, And it has spread as far as probably St. Louis or up against the Rockies, but it hasn't gotten across the Rockies. And occasionally the Japanese beetles are found. Let's take a look at our next beetle, which is the spotted cucumber beetle, another beetle that can be pretty damaging to vegetable gardens. And so you'll often see damage that may not, you'll see chewing. And so there are a couple ways of chewing. They can actually just eat the leaf and scallop the edges of the leaves, or they can rasp away. And a lot of these will rasp away and skeletonize a leaf. Let's take a look at the Altissia flea beetle, and you can see the damage it's doing to this leaf is where it feeds. It's scraping away the cells, and it's rasping instead of really chewing. And then the elm leaf beetle, and sometimes it's the larva of the beetle that does most of the damage. This is the elm leaf beetle. And let's take a look at our next one, the alder leaf beetle. And this is actually, I believe, the larval stage in this picture. Let's take a look at this. This is the alder leaf beetle, and you can see it's skeletonizing the leaf, and these are larvae. That's not the adult beetle. And they go through full metamorphosis. Now, before I move on to a couple other beetles, there is a beetle that was introduced into Southern California called the red palm weevil, and it is particularly damaging to palm trees, originally discovered down in Laguna Beach and feeding on Phoenix canariensis, the Canary Island date palm. And the grubs are quite large, and Mark Hodel is a professor at UC Riverside in the entomology department working on exotic introduced pests. And he often works trying to develop biocontrol strategies to control these exotic pests. And so he'll go back to the original country and look for the beetles or whatever the pest is and try and find something that's parasitizing it or eating it, and then bring that back and get it released here to bring that pest under control. So I want to show you this little videotape of Mark in Indonesia looking for the red palm weevil. And I don't want to give away what he's going to do, but this is a great little video clip for you to look at. Let's take a look at our first video clip. And when you come back, we'll talk more about the red palm weevil and some other destructive beetle pests.
Larvae cooked with our colleagues here from Lonsom. But now I think it's time to man up and try and eat one in the raw like some of these fellows do. So you can see we have a big grub here. It's not the preferred life stage. Large head capsule on them, which I won't be eating. You can see him biting me.
So because he knows he's going
to
die.
It's time for man to bite back.
He did it.
No, just kidding. Actually, they are very sweet.
Very sweet?
It's very sweet.
I'm surprised. The skin is chewy. But those, they are pretty sweet to eat.
Very sweet.
So I've taken all the guts out. This is the exoskeleton, now the cuticle that's still ground up. A few splinters from the inside.
This is where it came from right now.
Okay.
But yeah, these are edible raw. They don't taste disgusting and they don't have a foul texture.
Adi, it's your turn.
No, I don't. Now I'm just give it for you because
I'm just
I have many, many opportunity here. So
okay.
Thank you, Adi. Adi's a gentleman. He's sharing because he can eat these anytime.
Yes.
Here's the rest of Mark's dinner.
So we've had a pretty good capture out of this log. It's probably about a quarter of a kg, at least, of pure protein here. And this is a food source that the FAO is encouraging local indigenous farmers like these fellows to grow. It's a very economic way to produce high quality, high volumes of protein. That is not a disgusting thing to eat at all. Not bad. Well, actually, just to prove it, I'll eat another one.
They're popular. You eat more?
They're sweet.
Oh.
I'm really surprised. They're quite sweet to eat.
It's just that the cuticle is a bit chewy.
Yeah.
Oh. But you could take that out and just throw it away or crunch it up. Swallow it.
Well, you know, Mark went there because the red palm weevil was introduced into Laguna Beach. He went to Indonesia, where it's native, looking for, you know, for a variety of reasons, but primarily maybe looking for a biocontrol agent or just to understand the species involved, because there's more than one species. There was some confusion about the name. But the red palm weevil was found because it killed a Canary Island date palm down in Laguna Beach. And our next video clip shows how to recognize that damage. Now, I want to say that after they found a few of them in these palms down in Laguna Beach, they treated some of the palms, they cut down some of the dead trees, but they never found any more of them, and none have been found since. So it looks like they either eradicated them from the Laguna Beach area, or they never spread out of there, that's for sure. There was some suspicion that there were some palms in Santa Monica infested, but it turned out that wasn't true. But let's take a look at our next video clip that talks a little more about the red palm weevil and what you need to keep an eye on. You know, the Canary Island date palm is extremely common palm tree grown throughout Southern California. But this weevil will, you know, it preferentially feeds on the Canary Island date palm, but it will go to any palm. And so we have a lot of palms in Southern California, only one native palm. But they're expensive plant material, and they've become signature plants for the landscape in California. And so if you lose a palm tree, it can be very expensive to cut it down. Plus, you've lost the tree, which had a lot of value. So let's take a look at our next clip so you can recognize what to look for on your palms and understand how they damage the palm tree. Let's take a look at this clip.
Laguna Beach. This is a typical funky neighborhood in Laguna. We've got sunshine, the ocean, and we've got palm trees. Behind me, the Canary Island date palm, one of the classic landscape palms in coastal Southern California. And it's right here in this neighborhood where one of the world's most damaging insect pests of palm trees has appeared, the red palm weevil. And this weevil was found just right up the street here in a palm tree that had the top fallen off and it landed in the driveway. An arborist was called out to remove it. And he found that the center of the palm had been eaten up and that these very large weevils were inside this palm tree. And this red palm weevil, which is infamous in other parts of the world because of the damage it's done to Canary Island date palms, just like the trees behind me here, as it feeds inside and it weakens the tree and eventually can kill the tree. And the red palm weevil has had an impact here in a very small neighborhood in Laguna Beach. And the challenge now to us is to find the red palm weevil, to see where it is in this neighborhood or if it's anywhere else, and to try to prevent the red palm weevil from establishing here in California, where it is a very, very serious threat to not only landscape palms, but the industry that supports the landscape palms and also our date industry here in California, which is both a producer of dates for consumption and also a supplier of many of the commercial date palms for our landscapes here in Southern California. One of the biggest challenges is finding the red palm weevil. We can go up to a palm tree, we can stare at it, we can look up 30 feet in the air, and we're not going to see the red palm weevil. We can look for very subtle symptoms on the new growth that comes out, but unless we can get right up into the crown of the palm tree and look at the base of these leaves, we really can't confirm that the red palm weevil is in there. We're relying on traps right now in Laguna Beach, traps that use a very, very attractive chemical pheromone or chemical that attracts other palm weevils in. And the weevil uses this to overwhelm a palm tree. When the palm is infested, they release this chemical that attracts other palm weevils to the tree. And together, they weaken the tree and they make an area that's very conducive for the development of the weevil inside the palm tree. And in fact, they make it so good that the weevils have no reason to leave the palm tree. They have no reason to go out. And again, this just makes it harder for us to find this weevil. So hopefully when the weather warms up, we're going to see red palm weevils start to fly and be attracted to the traps. But in the meantime, we're trying to get the word out for those that work amongst palm trees and those that work in palm trees to know what to look for and what subtle symptoms can cue us in to palms that may show symptoms of the red palm weevil and currently be attacked by the red palm weevil. When we're talking about damage in the Canary Island date palm or in any other type of large palm, the red palm weevil wants to be deep in the center, the newest, softest leaves, and they get in there. One of the challenges, obviously, are these spines. These are dangerous for anybody trying to get in here, and it makes it very difficult. But if we can cut into the base of this tree and get the base of one of these leaves out, what we can see here are chewing damage where the larvae have fed in internally in the base of the palm, and as they come back out, they form these very distinctive cocoons that are woven out of the palm fiber. And these cocoons can be at the base of the frond or they can fall to the ground beneath the tree. And these are a classic symptom of the red palm weevil. And because of the difficulties in getting in there, if these fall out, it makes the job a lot easier for us to see. And another thing we can find at the base of the tree are these leaf sheaths that fall off. And these came out of the center of the palm when they were growing, and as they came out of the tree, they show some of the damage that the larva made. And they're like Swiss cheese. They've been eaten through so many times as they were wrapped around the center leaf. So we need your help. If you notice any of these signs of damage, like we showed you with the leaf sheaths, please call the CDFA Report a Pest hotline. And the number to call is 1-800.
So that's Nick Nissen. Nick was the entomologist for Orange County Agricultural Commissioner. He's retired now. Congratulations, Nick. On to other exciting adventures in his life. And he was explaining what was going on with the red palm date weevil, or the red palm weevil, I should say, down in Laguna. Well, they found it only on a few trees down there, and they treated a lot of trees with insecticides. They did a lot of treatment. And then couldn't find any more of them. So we kind of got lucky. It's suspected that somebody actually brought that in for food. It's kind of interesting it got to Laguna Beach in the first place. And it's a unique spot for it to get to because Laguna Beach is surrounded by chaparral, probably for at least a mile. There's just nothing but chaparral and very dry chaparral. Now these beetles can fly probably that distance, but that's a long way for a beetle to fly. Even if it can fly that far, will it? And so it never was found anywhere but Laguna Beach, and now they can't find any more down there. So it looks like it disappeared or was maybe even eradicated. And but there was another important beetle that was introduced into California, and it is now well established in a variety of locations here in Southern California. And it's called Diaprepes, but it's the Diaprepes root weevil or the Caribbean root weevil or the citrus root weevil. Let's take a look at our picture of that. That's number 33. And this feeds heavily on, it feeds heavily on citrus. And the larvae feed on the roots. This is what the adult looks like. Now, they can have different color variants. So this can be anywhere from orange to yellow to kind of an off-white. It's a weevil, so it's got this distinctive head region that is characteristic of weevils. And it's got these black stripes with the background color being anywhere from orange to almost white. And let's take a look at the next picture. This is the grub, and this is underground. And it feeds on roots. And then after it feeds on the roots for probably about a year, it turns into a pupa, and this next picture is the pupa. Let's go to our next picture, which is 35. That's the pupa, and so the roots are badly damaged by the feeding from the larva, and then when they mature, they turn into this pupa, and then they'll come out of this pupal case as an adult weevil, and they'll come out of the ground because they're actually down in the ground. You'll see little holes in the ground, and then they'll walk up the trunk up into the tree and start feeding on the foliage, and they'll scallop the edges of the leaves. They'll eat on the edges of the leaves and leave it all scalloped. They have a wide host range, so they'll feed on palms, they'll feed on just a whole bunch of trees. I'm trying to think of some of the trees you see them on. And if they come up in the spring when there's a lot of new tender growth, they can really eat all the new growth. They tend not to eat the old growth because it's kind of hard and hard to eat. And where this has become well established down in San Diego County and Orange County and Long Beach, in some of the areas like on lemons, when they're heavily infested on that lemon, there's been a lot of feeding, you can just push the tree over. So it's particularly damaging. And this had a state interior quarantine for this beetle until it just got to be too much of a problem and too widespread. And so the quarantine was canceled. There was no reason to have a quarantine anymore because it was all over the place. So it's no longer a regulated pest. But if you see this beetle on your citrus, you've got a big problem. And currently, though, it isn't very widespread in Southern California or in Los Angeles County. I haven't heard anything recently about it, but I knew quite a bit of the people who, quite a few of the people who were doing the research on this, and they were doing a variety of ways to disrupt their life cycle and disrupt their biology. One was spreading like a weed suppressive cloth, like a plastic mesh underneath the trees. And then when the beetles tried to come out of the ground, they would hit that mesh and they couldn't get out. Now what happens is they go up in the tree and they're feeding and they lay eggs on the foliage. When the eggs hatch, that just falls to the ground. The first instar, or the very youngest larval stage, falls to the ground. It burrows into the ground and starts feeding on the roots. So if you can separate the root system from the shoots with a barrier and prevent them from getting to the roots, you'll break up the life cycle and you'll control them. So that's the Caribbean root weevil, or the citrus root weevil. It is now in California. There's really no effort by the state government to specifically control it. I'm sure there's researchers working, and maybe people from CDFA are working to try and develop control strategies for the Caribbean root weevil. Unfortunately, you know, if you were to trim a tree that had the adults on it with a bunch of foliage and throw it in a truck and drive off, you might distribute this weevil all along your path where you drive, and you might drive miles to a dump. So we may see this more in the future, and it's a pretty serious threat to citrus production. But when we originally found it, we found it on coral trees and palm trees. So you can see it actually has a wide host range. There's quite a few different plants it'll feed on. Well, we're running out of time. We're almost at the end of the program. I want to tell you that our mystery plant is called Tillandsia. Tillandsias are in the bromeliad family, the Bromeliaceae. They grow as far north as Florida, where you've got Spanish moss, which is a Tillandsia. And these are different species of Tillandsias. They're called air plants. All you have to do is mist them. You can tie them on baskets and stuff. So they're great fun. And when they bloom, they have red flowers, very similar to bromeliad flowers. Now, next week, we're going to continue talking a little bit about insects. But most of what we're going to really talk about is integrated pest management, IPM. So we'll talk about that next week. I want to thank the crew in the control room for their hard work putting the show on today. And then I want to wish everyone who watched the show happy gardening. Get out and enjoy our wonderful weather and pray for rain. Until next week, I want to wish you all happy gardening.